Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy, as always, the longest serving member of the podcast community because I've been on every single one of them and hosted them. I am joined this week by a man who is apparently still doing the wrestling, but we'll find out if he actually is in a moment. I'm joined by Source Wrestling Champion, as of recording, the Gazelle, Grant McIvor. Welcome to the show.
Oh, and I don't think I'll be losing it anytime soon, so...
Keep that in mind. I don't want to like peek behind the curtain too much, but we are recording at the end of November, and this is due to go out start of February. I think you're fairly safe. You're not gonna have the title lost between now and then. So we'll go for the boring question, and we'll spin it from there as always, which is, how did you get into wrestling?
Yeah, how did I get into wrestling? Well, when I was a young boy, my father took me into the city to see a marching band. Unfortunately, my dad was obsessed with My Chemical Romance. I was a bit more into football. Right, so we've got our first pop culture reference out of the way.
Yep. We've got the bingo card guys.
Emo reference is done. Yep. So when I was a kid, I was mainly a big football fan. You get a few mentions on my Twitter, you can see I'm a big Celtic supporter. So when, I think the end of season 99-2000, that was the very first time I was a big got a season ticket, so I was obsessed with football. My room was literally lit up about football, and like, I had friends and family that kind of knew about wrestling, but I was just like one of those ones that's like, it's nothing to do with football. I don't care. It's, I think my first exposure was my aunt gave me a Stone Cold and Big Boss Man wrestling figures for my Christmas. I think it was that year, and there was a bit more questioning why I wasn't an action man.
Of course.
So, but obviously, summer comes around, there's no football on, there's no school, and it gets to the end of the summer holidays when I'm bored as hell, and I finally asked my dad, any chance you can stick the wrestling on TV, because I'm just end up finally getting to play with these two figures, and he was, oh, okay, sure. So I think he ends up putting on WCW Thunder. So I think it's just the first one that kind of came up. I think it might have been on a Saturday night on TNT, back in the UK times, it's Thursday Night Thunder, but it came on a Saturday night here. So I watched that, I finally go back to school, and eventually kind of hear people talking about wrestling. I'm just like, oh, I've started watching wrestling, and they're talking about the Undertaker and The Rock and Triple H. I'm like, who are these people? They're not Sid Vicious. So I watched Thunder, and I find it okay. It wasn't anything special. I'll watch it because as people are into wrestling, let's be a child and follow along with the crowd and trends. So they went and said, oh, no, don't watch Thunder. Watch WWF Raw. So on Friday night, Sky Sports get a watch. Okay, so eventually I asked my dad can I watch Raw on Friday night? And it's just one of those ones you have to take the remote from your parents on a Friday night. So they begrudgingly did that. And very first episode of Raw I seen had Kane chokeslam Undertaker through the ring. Mick Foley announced a TLC match, which I had no clue what a TLC match was, but the crowd's absolutely loving it. And throughout the show, the JR and King are announcing, oh, The Rock will be special guest referee for Lita versus Diamond Man for the women's title. And I'm just kind of like, who the hell's The Rock? Because they just keep on building up The Rock. The Rock must be a special guy, and all of a sudden he comes out last for the match at the end. Everyone goes mental, and I'm just like, this guy's special. I don't know why. I've not seen him, but he just walks, and everyone's going off their nuts. Like, okay, I'm hooked. This is me in. So from then on, I think for a good solid good year, I was just obsessed with wrestling. That was when I got hooked.
What a way to get introduced, though. Kane Undertaker. I mean, Kane Undertaker was how I got introduced, but in that time, it was a little less scary. Mine was an Inferno match, and there was fire. But, going through the ring, and then TLC, oh, man, what a time. Yeah. What a time to be introduced to it. And you got to see Lita. And Lita was everyone's favourite. But some people didn't want to say. They went, oh, it's Trish, but everyone's favourite was Lita. It's a little bit different. So you went from that point, so what was that, 2001, roundabout, you said, 2001?
Yeah, 2001.
How did you get from that point to actually going to do the wrestling?
I was on, off for years, like, So it's like 2001 Stone Cold beats The Rock at WrestleMania, so I become raging and fall away from wrestling for like a bit of a solid year. I think Ruthless Aggression was when I really got back into it. So I ended up watching it basically from until about, I think I'd say 2004. I think I kind of stopped watching it in 2004, 2005. I ended up getting a wrestling belt, which is still in my car. Cupboard, which my parents hated the fact that I bought. I wasn't supposed to buy it. I used their money to buy it when I was 12. So it was, I very much became the one of, right, okay, wrestling's a stupid thing I'm not supposed to like anymore. But eventually kind of came back into and watched it on and off again throughout the rest of the 2000s until The Rock finally came back, which is when I became like an IWC complete mark. Okay, this is me getting every aspect of the wrestling business in my head. I'm on the internet learning what's actually everything about until I finally find SWA has a training school in Scotland. So I ended up I decided Red Scottish wrestling training, and they had fixed it, so they were the very first things that came up. So I ended up looking at that and decided, okay, maybe I'll try and head off there. I went to see the Kelvin Brawl at the Kelvin Hall, which obviously with the last wrestling show at the Kelvin Hall, Grado and Robert Florence versus Greg Kempel, Red Lightning. That's my first wrestling main event that I ever seen, which is absolutely bizarre. But after that show, just actually seeing what these guys were doing, because I remember seeing wrestling shows advertised in Scotland and just thinking, oh, it's just your everyday people just deciding to pretend to be a wrestler. Well, they've just rented it at home, and essentially that's what it is. I actually got to see it firsthand and see that these guys are actually really good. They don't decide, oh, have we kind of carry on and laugh about it. They actually do put on a professional show, which is absolutely outstanding. So eventually I decided to just bite the bullet and go to SWA, which is now Source. Up in Pollock Shaws. That was my very first session.
So, I mean, I'm just going right back to pretty much what started. You said, what belt did you buy? What was the belt?
The big gold belt.
I said the big gold belt. Right, but WCW, Well, that kind of makes sense. If you started watching Thunder, that would probably be one of the belts you were drawn towards anyway.
The World Heavyweight title on Raw. It was weird because I had SmackDown on Sky One, which I could watch. I didn't have Sky Sports at a certain point when like Triple H was the big guy on Raw with the World Heavyweight title, so it was something like, oh, I can't get to see that as much, so I was a bit more intrigued by that, and just the fact that the World Heavyweight title was the most gorgeous wrestling title ever made. I think any wrestling fan can agree with that, so it's just like, I kind of want that. So I ended up getting a child-sized but actual proper replica. It wasn't like a kind of plastic one you get at Toys R Us. It was a miniature leather metal one. So that was essentially what I kind of bought with my birthday money. But because it took 2 months to arrive, I thought I'd cancelled it and therefore spent the rest of my birthday money.
I
spent it 2 times over.
I had one of the miniatures. Well, I bought on eBay and the listing said adult size replica, and it was the Winged Eagle Attitude Era belt.
Yeah.
And I was so excited to get this because it was a steal. 80 quid. I thought, that's a steal. I'm getting that. And it arrived and it was the kid size replica. I was furious. I just could not believe it. But at that point, I was just turned 18 or something. I'd had my job and I was living at home, so I had to pay digs. And I bought that one and the European belt, and I was like, oh, I mean, that was 125, and I was thinking 80 quid, that's all right, it's pretty good, but no, I was good. So how weird is it, because Thunder then you would have possibly seen like Filthy Animals, things like that, Conan and Rey Mysterio. How weird is it seeing Rey Mysterio again with a mask
I don't even think I remembered him at that point. I think the only thing I still remember from Thunder was Sid Vicious. I still just remember like Outsiders versus Sid Vicious, or even Sid Vicious part of the Outsiders, which is weird. It was kind of, as soon as I seen WWE, a lot of stuff from that stuff, WCW just went kind of in my head. All I knew from WCW was like Sting, Goldberg. After this is more than after the fact, because school are playing with Sting and Goldberg wrestling figures in the playground amongst the WWE figures. And the only thing I loved about the WCW figures was they had metal, they had magnets in the fists that you could do flips with.
Oh, very, yeah, I had a Raven one, and it was just, yeah, it was just amazing. Raven, I remember a DDP one as well, I think, but for some reason, I don't know why, I don't know if it's because I bought them secondhand, but
yeah,
the fists were the wrong way around, so they never actually connected. So they always resisted each other when they were going towards. So I think someone may have had a little bit of a go on one of them and just took them out, the magnets, put them back in the other way. But no, they never actually connected, and it was hilarious because I still tried. I mean, I was young. I still tried to think they would connect. You quite like your action figures, yes, as I am aware on your social media. So do you still have your Big Boss Man, Steve Austin, and all that?
I don't know. I think they went out with the childhood clear out years ago. So they're no longer in my possession.
There's always that one moment. Oh, I mean, you said you kind of dropped away from the wrestling in and out of it. Yeah, there's always that one moment where you think, "Oh, I'm too old for this. I'm too old for figures. Too old. I'm a grown up. I'm a damn grown up." I had the same at 16, where I got rid of all my figures, and I mean all of them. So I had the Hall of Fame ones. I had Yokozuna, Junkyard Dog. They were amazing. But I thought, no, I'm a grown man now. I go get my hair cut to the hairdressers. I don't get shaved by my dad on a Sunday. I am a grown up, and yeah, got rid of them for 40 quid, and I've never regretted anything more, because now I'm just like, that was a cool Yokozuna figure. So you like to collect figures nowadays, don't you? Cause I know you've got a Guerrero, am I right in thinking that?
Yeah, I have two Guerreros written off. I have an elite one, which I found out is now worth about £300 still box, which part of me is kind of like, maybe I could have just kept in the box. But then again, that was like 7 years ago I went and bought that, and I was just bought it because that was me in the prime of just being a big adult with disposable income that loves wrestling again. But only one I have kept in the box, and I don't know if you can see it up there, is a Fiend.
I can see the box, yeah. So I'll take your word for it, it's the Fiend.
There you go.
Alright, okay.
So I've bought that and just kept it in case it does rise up in value, because it was the very first Fiend figure. So that's me being Gary Vaynerchuk. I'm decided to collect all the, there'll be baseball cards next.
I was exactly the same with the disposable income thing. I spent an afternoon in Elgin, which is interesting because there's not many places to go, trying to collect all five of the Spirit Squad. And did I get there? Yes, I bloody did. I got all of them. You had to play the gambling game at Argos, because when you order a figure, you have to.
You get
the one you want. But no, they're at my folks. I've got all unboxed though, because I wanted to play with them, even though I was way too old to be playing with them. I got all of them. Nikki came with pom poms. I've got Mikey. He came with the Big Show, I think, of Battle Pack kind of thing. I spotted one of them and I thought, right, I'm spending the day. I'm going to every toy shop I can find, and I am getting all of them. And somehow I have the Spirit Squad. I'm going to have to find them. I have to get them because they need to be on display somewhere. They're definitely getting kept. So one of the figures, you said two Eddie Guerreros.
Yep.
Eddie Guerrero will be one of your absolute favourites. What was it about Eddie that made him one of your favourites?
I kind of put a post on my Instagram a couple of days ago during his anniversary, which I kind of feel like why people kind of look at my, especially my age, love him. I said, for me, he was just, he's entertaining. He's like, he just comes out winning that kind of sense of my kids sitting watching SmackDown at 10 o'clock in the morning. But 12 years old, he just has that. It's that cheeky entertainment, because still, like, no one's done a gimmick kind of like the lie, cheat, and steal, where you can be a good guy and do all the things bad guys do, and still have the fans absolutely love you. Could you do it in just that certain way that, like, anybody in wrestling can try and do that stuff now, and I don't think it would have that same effect. Essentially now people kind of just going, oh, you're just trying to do what Eddie did. But it's, I say a lot for us, people kind of my age and yourself, where like Eddie got taken away from us like a certain age. It's like that kind of Kurt Cobain effect. Like Nirvana fans always just have that certain attachment to Kurt Cobain because he was staying away young. And I think Eddie has the same factor, but when we kind of grow older, especially, and like me as a self try mature as a wrestler, and I look back at all the stuff Eddie did, it's just like his timing within the ring is what you want to look for and perfect as a wrestler. It's even when you kind of just look at him properly, and it's all these wee subtle things that he does, and he does so well. Like you, things I kind of pick up. I remember watching, was it an episode where he just kind of comes in as a tag team partner and interrupts the ref count, and the referee kind of just argues with him, and he just kind of goes back out and just holds the tag rope. It was like, I had the tag rope the whole time. It was just like, obviously, I'd just seen you come in. I was like, nah, I had the tag rope. It's just, he was an entertainer. It's like, he was a top entertainer. He was a top class wrestler, and he still had that kind of really ability as well.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't think, I mean, he passed away when I turned 15 when he passed. So he passed away when I was 15. And I don't think, I loved the 2004 run onwards when he won the title and everything. Mm-hmm. I loved that. But I don't think I appreciated Eddie Guerrero enough when I was that age. So nowadays I'm watching wrestling with a bit of a different eye. I never really was, or tried not to be that guy who would go, backstage issues and all. I didn't want to be that guy. Never be the internet mark person. But nowadays, because now I just watch wrestling because I just want to watch wrestling. I want to bloody enjoy it. I don't want to analyze it. But going back and watching his stuff, man, it's just every movement meant something. I compare him, totally different style, but Randy Orton's the same. Every move that is done in the match is done for a reason.
Yeah, it's like moving with purpose and not wasting any motion is something you get taught to try and perfect when you're in a wrestling school. It's just like, it's one of those ones that you can try years and years and years and never get it. And there's people that just, it looks so natural to them. That's essentially what we kind of look at guys that are wrestlers in kind of levels of WWE. It's just they make things look so effortless. And you try and do it yourself, and you try and do a match yourself, and you're like, well, why can't I never do it the same way? It's just because they're absolutely unbelievably good.
Absolutely. I mean, time, like I said, again, when you're younger, you don't really appreciate timing, but man, when you watch stuff now, when you're a bit older, you're just like, how it's split second stuff between it looking really good, which it does, or catastrophically bad. Either way, there's a second either way. For that to happen. Another favourite of yours that I know of, again, it's not like I haven't been stalking you, I've done research, is Christian, which I'm a proponent of. I love Christian, definitely one of my favourites as well. Again, was Christian just another one of those just cool guys that struck with you?
Even Christian's a bit more, like recently I took the inspiration of Christian's entrance jacket and trousers, because it's just one of those ones I'm looking like nobody else is doing that kind of style anymore. Like, obviously, like, wrestling's evolved over years, and like the way we were the first person that wore long tights. People didn't used to wear long tights. Somebody have had to introduce that somewhere, and then all of a sudden people have picked it up. And I was one of the ones with like no one's done the big jacket and trousers since Christian, so I'll take that and it helps me stand out. But Christian's one of those guys that just always was just working hard underneath. Like Edge and Christian was one of the very first tag teams I watched, and I absolutely hated them because I was a big Hardy Boys fan. And then you kind of just rewatch back and you realise why you hated them and why they're so good. And especially as well with Christian, when Christian moved over to TNA and became Christian Cage, it was one of those ones like he kind of just disappeared from WWE, and I wasn't watching W at the time, or even TNA, but I had friends that were similar to them, they were all talking about Christian Cage. I'm like, who's Christian Cage? It's Christian from WWE. And it's like, you're talking about him if he's one of the best wrestlers in the world. And you're like, mate, he is. Well, in TNA, he is. But just showing you a little, somebody can be in a big pond and then go to somewhere else and they can completely shine out and finally show how good they actually are. And you can go back and watch Christian, you just see how different his style was when you're actually watching from a different perspective.
Absolutely. That was TNA's first proper big name, yeah. I would say. I mean, yeah, guys like the ones that either WWE didn't want, like Jeff Jarrett, or the ones that just wouldn't go, like Sting. But I think Christian was the first. He was the first one to proper jump. Because even announced in 2005, I remember watching SmackDown, and it was saying, Christian's final match tonight. I'm like, wait, what? What's happening here? And then 3 months later, here he is, popping up in TNA. Of course, I was watching on the Wrestling Channel at the time. And it was huge. It was a huge sign. But yeah, Christian's just one of those best guys. Of course, he would have been the first one of the first teams you saw because TLC being announced, which was the Hardy's.
That was them in the ring think calling for a strike because I fed up with the Dudleys hitting them with tape, putting them through tables, and the Hardys jumping off ladders. They'll already ban ladders and tables. No, they're all going to be in a match with your chairs if you want them. So it's just that. It's essentially they were one of the kind of main events I was already introduced to as a kid. They were already getting a lot of TV time promo-wise and wrestling-wise. So Christian's been there since day one for me as well.
You mentioned your love of the Hardy Boys. Again, kindred spirits in this. I think we're going to find a lot of similarities here. Hardy Boys were my guys. I started watching 98-99, round about then. So I'd dipped in and out just because I didn't have the facilities to watch. I'd have to rely on my mate recording stuff and going over to his house to watch it. But Hardy's, man, I was always Jeff. My other friend, he was always Matt. And we'd wrestle at school. And we'd always be either Matt or Jeff because I'd be the one that would climb onto things and balance on it. Can't do that anymore. But I could at the time. And the Hardys were just... Again, you're talking about different. Nobody was wrestling in their cargo pants and ripping off their tiny thin tops. And Jeff with the your mum's tights up their arms. And I'm assuming you did the same as I did then. If your mum was chucking out any tights or that, you'd be like, "I'll have them for a minute," and they'd be going, "That's a bit suspicious." Suss that. And just going up and just cutting them up and putting them on.
I was fortunate I had football socks. I did my football socks.
That's a bit more manlier.
it's not as manly when you're breaking your mum's bed doing swanton bombs on it. So
thankfully, I mean, again, I was old enough to know better, but thankfully a video camera disappeared from my house that had a video of me attempting a swanton bomb off a wheelie bin. I was in my late teens, so I shouldn't be doing it. But thankfully, that tape has never been recovered, or otherwise it would be on YouTube by now. But we all did it. Said, don't try this at home. You always find different ways. Oh, I didn't say my home. I didn't say my garden. I didn't say school. And then they started saying school. You ruined that.
Just don't do it anywhere. Don't do it anywhere, please.
I think that's what the advert is now. Don't try this.
We've got video games where you can pretend you're doing it, so just use that and your figures. Buy your figures and buy your games.
Speaking of video games, great segue. Awesome. Right. So you're big into the wrestling video games as well. Where did that, was that kind of like, just did you get back into that when you got back into wrestling, or was that kind of like what you're in between watching wrestling back into the games? Or
I think that was like, it was part and parcel with the wrestling as well. Like, I always been half a gamer, even when I was a preteen or teenager, just getting gaming magazines. So anytime I kind of fell away from wrestling and learn about all the new wrestling gaming development, I'd be like, all right, I'll always get the wrestling games, and I still always kind of just half played them. So like, okay, I'll get back into it and see who's new, so I know who's going to be in the game. So I'd always, so sometimes when a game would come out, it'd always be that refresher for me when I was a kid. And phase is going to come back in again for me. So it was when I got wrestling games as a kid, it was just when the first time when I started watching wrestling, I was just like, okay, video game, any video game, like SmackDown 2, WCW Nitro, fucking Thunder, Attitude and Warzone. What the hell are they? Why are Clay making video games? They can't make video games. Wrestling games are always something I kind of always kept coming back to. It was just something that was always quite fun. Like Here Comes the Pain is always one for me that I play and replay. It's always Here Comes the Pain or No Mercy for folk. I have No Mercy. Just N64 is something I can never really properly play. I've always just ended up playing N64 ports on like GameCube or something. But I think the last proper wrestling game I got was 2K14, and that was when I properly started training. So it'd be like, okay, I'm done, just try to do wrestling games. Now I'm going to focus on actual wrestling. And plus, I have all the best ones anyway.
I can't argue with that, to be honest. I'm still playing 2K20 for my sins, to be honest. It's just, like I said, this will be going out in like 2 months or something, two, three months, whatever, who knows. But I was playing 2K20 today and I was thinking, this is actually working, this is going well. And then Scott, because I made a bunch of Scottish wrestlers, yourself included, and then right at the end of my universe mode, Scotty Swift ran off. Nobody, an invisible man. You're ruining it for yourself, 2K20. You're just broken for the sake of it at this stage. It's just awful. How weird was it seeing that myself or others have made you in video games?
I think it's pretty surreal. It's just one of those ones where I'm not expecting myself to kind of get made. As well as EC, or obviously where you'll make a version of it, I call of like somebody like Viper or something, it's because all the dead popular, all of a sudden somebody takes the time to make me. And I'm just thinking back to when I saw Raven debut in WWE and decided to make him in SmackDown 2 because it wasn't SmackDown 2, and remembering how long it took to make him look absolutely perfect, and I realised all that actually has is the time someone takes to make me, which is quite humbling, pretty nice as well, when you just see somebody take the time for that. And if I had the game, I'd probably download my character as well, so it saves me the time I actually make myself.
SmackDown 2 create mode. I remember how awkward anything was on there, and I'd hear at that point, so I mean it was even harder.
The background music still lives in my head.
I can remember, which one was it? Might be Shut Your Mouth, possibly. I would spend my time on Game Facts, and it took me about, I'm going to say, a good 5 hours to make Charlie Haas.
Yeah.
Of all people, Charlie Haas had to use a certain design, had to get it so it's skin tone. And thinking back now, I didn't even like Charlie Haas. Why did I spend the time to make him? It was just, I just don't get it.
I really love the Team Angle period. The most strongest tag team is just, it's more got into wrestling. I did more gain affection of the actual technical just wrestlers. It's like, cause they actually just make the wrestling things look pretty. Instead of just being big fucking brawlers and I'll hit one or two moves and decide, no, I know this weird as hell move that you've never seen before. And I'm just like, oh, okay, this is quite interesting. It's like you get that wrestling nerd feel coming in from you. It's like, oh, this is really different and really cool. And then you're just like, oh no, here's a big flip. I've seen him in salt before. I want to see the Hungarian back stretch.
I would absolutely agree with you with the Team Angle thing, but I was making post-Team Angle Charlie Haas with Rico. So I don't know why I made him. It was just, I think it's just because I was on Game Facts and I thought, ooh, I'll make that. And I was just, waste of time. Absolutely. I never used them afterwards either. I'm absolutely agree with you. I'm definitely a proponent. I like logical wrestling. You know, it's like people like the brawlers make sense to me. But every so often I do like a pretty wrestling match where they do pretty holds.
It's annoying as like a wrestler. Like training matches in the school. Sometimes you do stuff where it's just like, you're doing stuff to either like pop the boys or even kind of entertain yourself as you're wrestling, because I want to do stuff that I want to do. but it's like you get into an actual crowd and you're like, you do this stuff and the crowd doesn't react to it. So sometimes you're wondering, like, are we just putting on a boring show for the crowd? But there's other times, like, if I'm in the crowd and I'm watching a wrestling match like that, that I kind of want to see, I'm more intent, just like I'm actually looking at every intrinsic thing that's happening. That's why I'm not reacting, unless I kind of do something, like in a pop site. Like, I'll say a wrestling match I think everybody should kind of rewatch Regal versus Benoit, where they do the exact same thing. They just wrestle at the beginning and you just have the crowd kind of, oh, they're just kind of nice and watching. It's all silent. You can see people walking about and you're wondering, are people even paying attention to this, until Regal or Benoit has a chop and all of a sudden the crowd just go, oof. So sometimes it's something I need to learn how to do when I'm actually in a match, when we go back finally. And for a place, I've had that experience of, if a big ADM's listening, he'll remember me and him had a match about 4 years ago inside the Source Wrestling School, which was just completely silent. There maybe about 20, 25 people there, but it was near enough silent for the entire match, and we're just kind of like, did they hate that? Or were we just doing the things that are just like, they're just really paying attention to it? Because we've always been told you can tell good silent and bad silent in wrestling crowds, which is like people are being absolutely silent and just obviously paying attention to you, like they're watching a film. Or if you can hear a wee kind of murmur going, did you catch I'm a Celebrity last night, Sean? So there's different kind of reactions that I kind of match that can be deemed boring can get.
Definitely, I am that kind of fan. I don't react to shows, which is super irritating. Not just for wrestlers to watch me just go. But for myself as well, because I'm like, I want to show that I'm into it, but I want to watch it. So I don't want to be shouting like that.
Comedians complain about silent laughter. It's just so they do a gig that's entirely full of people that have that silent laugh, and you're just like. You find my jokes funny, and it's just one guy just going, no, make noise. It's good when a crowd makes noise, which is why I kind of love Gavin so much. Sometimes you don't need to do anything. You don't need to do anything. But Gavin, you can move your hand and just kind of, you can go for a pint at the bar, and they'll still make a bit of noise because I just go, why are you going to the pint, going to the bar for a pint?
Gavin is a very, I mean, I haven't actually went to a show on Gavin, but I've been watching him back on YouTube. Yeah. God, that's a crowd. Yeah. That's probably a crowd every wrestler wants.
Yeah.
They're just absolutely off their, can't swear on the show, and this myself is almost breaking it, but they're just off their minds on sugar and they just want to see people just smack each other about, and it's just amazing.
Once you go back to wrestling as for kids kind of deal, like, as much as I'm an adult and you're an adult, we kind of have friends that just absolutely love wrestling and we get engrossed in it and we do go to wrestling shows. When we get to kids, when you get to like family friendly shows and it's just adults, you do not get the same energy and the same reaction as you do from kids, because adults have shame. They don't want to go, oh my god, there's a kid, the kids are just filled with sugar, going, they don't care. Like, I remember doing Paisley 3 years ago, and there was about 1,000 people there. It's the most of our wrestling. We were on an 8-man tag match. We weren't announced. I had maybe a handful of matches at this point still, as well as the rest of the guys. Nobody really knew who we were, especially kids. The kids still didn't care. They still just went, here comes wrestlers. You guys are cool. You guys are in doing bloody wrestling. We love you regardless. Are you a good guy? Yeah, I'm a good guy. Yes, on you go. It was like, even if it was like, oh, I don't know who the hell you are, but I'm going on you go. I'm going to go along with the act of we still shout and bawl like we don't give a damn.
I love going to shows up here because, well, they're all family friendly ones up here anyway. Yeah. But WrestleZone being the big example, I don't like that I sit in silent and watch. But I don't mind, because there's a good 20, 30 there that are just going absolutely nuts. Yeah. Like, that's fine. It's not awkward because they're doing my job. They're pretty much doing what I'm thinking. And I can just watch and go, I'm enjoying this. I'll have to remember some of it for writing later, but I'm enjoying the moment. That's why my reviews are pretty, like, if you can tell whether I've been at a show or I watched it on YouTube, how much detail I actually remember, because if I go to live, I don't remember anything other than what I felt. Yeah. But if I'm watching it on YouTube, I just go through the moves and go, well, that was pretty cool. That was neato. Or if it's Govan's case, going, they're a bit rough to the females or to the portly lads. They called them fat quite a lot. But it's just, man, if when shows return, I think I'll probably hear the Govan crowd from here, because it's going to be that just nuts. So back to your training. I started SWA, which became Source. What was it like taking that first bump or hitting the ropes or just your first day?
Oh, well, my very first session, I was sick twice. Which I'm lucky and for hard work I developed myself to get to a decent athletic stage where I do go throughout the kind of drills and trials quite well. But in that very first session, I don't know if anyone's familiar with the infamous card workouts, but I end up doing the card workouts, which essentially, just to educate quickly, every suit on a card deck is given an exercise. So spades are usually squats, clubs are usually push-ups, hearts are core work, and diamonds are movement. So the very first session, I'm given this as our warm-up, and I think I get to about 60 push-ups before I'm eventually doing on my knees, and I'm struggling with that. Move on to our very first drill, which is set goes, essentially just getting yourself up off the ground and back down on the ground again into a fighting stance. End up being sick from that. Next drill is up and overs, where we can, if you've seen Cody Rhodes do it, you just basically run to a corner, push yourself up and jump backwards and duck a clothesline. Did that, end up being sick again. Eventually, the coach at the time, Demo, Nike Ellen Dane, just kind of went, yeah, you feeling okay, son? And just sent me away, basically split me up for the rest of the class, and I went my way with another trainer to take my first bumps based on tons of padded mats, which made it a lot better to begin with. So I'm just basically learning how to fall. When you kind of learn how to fall, it's when being gradually took into it, it's okay, and then you take the first one on the actual proper ring, and you're just like, that's a bit of a game changer. Yeah, basically, when I went back to training initially after lockdown, before we went back into another tier 4 lockdown, the first bump was just one of those ones. I was like, here we go, and it's just like, okay, my body's not felt that for a while. It's not felt that impact trauma for a while. It's going to take a bit back getting used to again. So it's one of those ones, it's just that big shock. It's, you're welcome to wrestling.
Yeah.
The one you take yourself is a lot better than the one that's forced on you from a slam. So
sometimes
you're better off with that one.
It's whatever. It's like when I was younger and I thought, oh, I might be able to give it a go. And then just the sheer thought of it was just like, no. And then I just ate instead. So I've decided that I prioritize just eating food than actually training to be a wrestler. Other than that, I do have lofty dreams to one day maybe do a couple sessions, maybe learn how to safely not neck myself and do so, be a manager maybe, or do something in front of a crowd, because I've done some crowd stuff and it was really amazing. It was so much fun, but I felt like I could do more, but not actually physically do wrestling, because I'll leave that to people that don't mind hurting themselves, whereas I would, if I stand up funny in the morning, I'm just like, nah, that's my day ruined. So it's just made for me. How was your first match though? Do you remember your first match?
First match was against Glenn Dunbar, which I don't think I could have had a better opponent, because Dunbar's been around Scottish wrestling before Scottish wrestling even existed. I think that's not a dig at his age, but he's just been at all and done all. He's basically wrestled every single person worth noting in Scottish wrestling. He wrestled with Grado before Grado was called Grado. He was called Grant Dunbar. He was supposed to be his brother. If you remember your history with Scottish wrestling, but I was extremely nervous. I'd basically trained for about 2.5 years Well, I think 5 years ago yesterday, I actually got a spot in the battle zone last minute for SWA, but it was actually still a couple of months before I eventually got an actual singles one-on-one match. So it was with Glenn Dunbar. I had on red tights that were quite loose. I borrowed Alex Kavanagh's boots because mine still hadn't came in yet. But literally it was just a complete script for me in my head. Just go, right, we'll just keep it by the numbers. We'll do this, we'll do that. You do this, take this, come back with this, and that's a finish. And it was just me kind of going, that in my head, make sure that is done, I'm doing that. And like no chance of ad-libbing for myself. And it was just, so I finally, I kind of got that out of the way. It was one of those ones where eventually I'm finally doing it in front of a crowd. And no matter how much drills and cardio I was doing beforehand, I was out of breath within like 3 minutes because all of a sudden I'm in front of a crowd and performing and I'm forgetting how to breathe. That's one of the things when you start learning wrestling, you're like, oh, you need to learn how to breathe when you're actually in the match, because sometimes your nerves and the adrenaline takes over and you actually forget how to just function and focus. But I end up getting my kind of good stuff, and I had a good number of friends and family that came along as support, and eventually had that kind of good noise and that reaction when I came out, which made it a lot better. And I was just finally happy to get my match in.
That's the thing with wrestling. I can only sympathise because nerd out myself. But you do all the training and do all the cardio stuff and get all the moves safely. But then you go out and you have to go, right, I've got to do that, and I've got to get the crowd to react how I want them to. And then you start overthinking. Oh my God, they're booing me when they should be cheering me. I've got to get them to cheer me now. He's coming towards me. I need to duck this, but I also need them to still cheer me. And how am I going to do that? It's just...
Yeah, there's so much multitasking that when you're just watching wrestling, you don't really understand what they do. You just say, oh, I'll try to be a wrestler, and then I can go and wrestle. It's fine, and then you actually still have to do it. As a profession, you just like, okay, come out, make sure I get the crowd reaction, make sure I'm paying attention to the crowds out there, make sure I'm paying attention to the crowd. I actually remember what I'm doing inside this match. Or something we've screwed up somewhere. Do a wee bit of ad-libbing just to make sure we cover it. The fans don't know what we're supposed to do. So if we can play it off, you don't know. You don't know how many mistakes you've actually seen in a match. And you don't know how many things and mistakes you've seen you thought were mistakes and were actually planned. Which actually just blows your mind. I kind of like to do that in matches. I've got this weird thing where I kind of want to have my matches to have the rewatchability of a film like Hot Fuzz. Like you have to rewatch a match to see something you completely missed, which is, one, is weird, and two, you need to see a lot of stuff with wrestling as well. You need to make it obvious. But unless I'm having a really big match, I don't think I can have that loads where you kind of daft things to watch to encourage somebody to watch again.
I mean, you're saying, you said something like that, but that's like an Eddie Guerrero. Like, say, so subtle, you go back and watch it and you'll find something new. And you'll go, oh, when the referee was admonishing the other person in the corner, not holding a tag rope, he held it up because he's being the good boy. He's holding the tag rope he's supposed to. But you didn't see that because you're too busy looking at the other guy. And it's just, it's I like that kind of wrestling because I like that kind of thing. I like to see subtle things and just pick up new things, because it's all well and good watching the same match over and over again. But TLC matches, I still find rewatchability in them, because the original ones, the Hardys, Edge, Christian, Dudleys, because there's always something happening in the background that you never noticed the first time and you didn't notice the
especially
second
matches
time.
Especially with matches that there's so much kind of going on as well. You watch those matches and they do direct them as well enough, where it's almost like, oh, there's a big spot happening here. I give this a bit of time, a bit of breathing space. Next one, it's all like a big domino effect. And then sometimes you just like a big brawl where, like, if there's a big brawl out inside the actual venue, one part of the crowd is going to get to see something that the other part of the crowd won't get to see, and another part. So every kind of part gets something special to them. I was like, oh, did you see such and such? It's like, no, I didn't see that. It was when he was over at us, It was when we was fighting over by our table. He went and grabbed something to help me with that. I didn't see that. That was so cool that you got to see that. It was so cool that I actually got to see something you never got to see.
Absolutely. I mean, you said your first actual Scottish. Would it just be your first independent, first wrestling show in general, or was it? Did you go WWE when they came to Glasgow or whatever beforehand, or was it Scotland Brawl just your first full stop?
Very first wrestling show I think I seen was up at Seaton Sands holiday camp. As I was away with my mum and brother, the Seaton Sands holiday camp, and there was one of the days where the holiday camps were in, the wrestling holiday camps were in the venue. So I ended up just kind of going there to see what's up. I got to see the wrestling, which is pretty cool. So because it was the very first time I'd actually got to see a wrestling show. I don't remember too much from it, apart from I think there was only four people on the show. Say four or five, because it was one was had a valet. Biggest thing I remember is, for some reason, one of the guys seemed to be ripping off Jamie Noble. He came out in the wife beater and jean shorts with the valet, who herself was in a wife beater and jean shorts, and doing the whole, just being a dirty wrestler. His wife helps cheat to help him win the match. Then there's another match on of another good guy and a bad guy, and eventually the main event is them in a tie team. Good guys go over, everyone cheers, yay, we get our foam fingers and autographs off of them. But after that, I never got to see anything until Kevin Brawl.
The whole time, as soon as you said there's four wrestlers, I was like, right, I know how that's three matches, so that's fine. Because when the first time I saw W3L, it was the same for the first couple of years. They took up six guys. That's fine. So that's your first half done. The main event is the guys from the first half coming out at the end. So it's easy.
I laugh at that now, because just like four guys are both getting wrestled two matches, get two match wage, but you also got the promoter. You think of the promoter just going, like, we've got all these people in, and I'm only to pay four people. Magic.
I mean, if I wouldn't be surprised if they went, right, they've done that. Oh, they're still brawling at the end. Battle Royal, three matches. Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Started.
There you go.
That's the whole show done. A lot of people during this lockdown, and we'll speak about your actual match. Like I said, there's no actual schedule to this podcast, but I want to speak about the 128 man mega wrestling tournament of doom, whatever it was called, that we set up at the start of lockdown because I was super bored, and you're one of the main ones that did promos for just about every round. Were you just sitting there just the same, just sitting there going, I am bored, I need to do something during this?
Yeah, it was just one of those ones. I'd finally felt I had the ball rolling with what I was doing in wrestling. I felt like I had a decent enough character. I had started to get matches in all different promotions. It was one of those ones I wanted to just keep going. And eventually we had, COVID's happened. The world's going to stop. You guys were happy enough to put on a tournament for us. I'll be voting to them on Twitter. So just like, you know, I'll have a bit of fun. I'll just act daft and just give myself a wee bit of free license, because it's something I always feel like I need to work properly on my promos, but you always get the sense of, if I'm doing this for a show and it looks stupid, it's canon to my character, or canon in life. Eventually I had this just comedy tournament. I was like, I'll just have free reign. I'm not afraid to make an idiot myself, so I can have a bit more creativity and leeway. So I ended up doing the initial one where it was just like, I'm going to promote myself in this tournament. Well, even as this tournament, it's a wrestling tournament, but without actual any wrestling. And we had that, just like me, completely confused. I'm acting as if I'm one big brother. This is a reality wrestling show that's unvoted. I'm in the Next Factor. Do I need to sing a song? I know a few Westlife songs, but Westlife songs themselves are covers.
We'll get onto that. It's your loading screen. Your entire loading screen was my personal favourite. That was near the end, where you just. I don't think you even spoke during it. You just literally, just did a fighting stance and would change.
Oh, the It just that was one I was just like, what can I do? I end up just firing up No Mercy. John Lockdown, you just see the whole fighting stance. So it's like your character. Just like even like Tony Hawk, it was I think I seen a TikTok or someone doing the Tony Hawk version, and I was like, I could do a wrestling version of that. So I just literally put like every daft little kind of gimmick I've done so far, so even just the debut tights, the original I'm a wrestler tights, the original Gazelle tights, eventually stupid things, a little working ring crew, working as a power forward, working me for some reason dressed up as Eddie Guerrero because I have Eddie Guerrero gear. But it's just like that me kind of daft creativity as well, because this year I wanted to you've seen one throughout the tournament, and I did it before my match with LJ Cleary, bringing back the 2003 Ruthless Aggression motion capture match cards of the turn face. We kind of do the move and then freeze. Wanted to bring that back. Wanted to bring that back this year, but no.
I love them. I still do. I mean, even to the point where I still loved them even when like they hadn't done it in time to do a new one with a belt. So they would still do their normal thing, and they would just kind of like just plonk the belt on top of the person's shoulder. Like Jericho was particularly bad. He would just do his big motion, his big, and then it would just be a belt right on his shoulder, and it was just
Charlie Vice went and pointed out one. But so there's a bloke on Twitter that is just reposting WWE 03 stuff, and you see Triple H go to put his thumbs on the belt and one just slips off, and you're just like, you can see that wee quick adjustment. Did anybody see that?
Oh man, I saw I think it was, I can't remember who it was, maybe SPRKIX design or possibly, but so someone's doing them on Twitter again with trying to get it back, and I'm all for it. If any promotion wants to do it, I am all in for I don't care where it is, I will watch them
CJ West from School of Irish Wrestling composed ones for their show back in February or January, I'm sure. If you can find them, I recommend watching them. I seen him post them up just after I'd post mine. I was like, you steal my gimmick? And he was just like, mate, those took me 2 weeks to make. I did mine an afternoon shoddily off of the TikTok software. He was like, no, I had guys come in and do the whole stuff. It took 2 weeks. It was monotonous. So you can see why, production-wise, WWE don't do it anymore.
I think it's definitely open to do it when the shows return, whenever they do, because I think a lot of companies will be just working with a core roster for a little bit.
Yeah.
So if there's any time, any Scottish wrestling promotion, do it. I'll love it. And if that's the most important thing to me, I want to do it. So you won.
Preferably mine.
You beat 120.
So Smash and if you're listening, Ruthless Aggression promos. So it's a million-dollar idea.
Absolutely. I'm in. I will invest. I have no money, but I will invest.
I keep cutting Billy off. I'm sorry.
So you beat 127 other wrestlers. Probably 100 of them didn't actually know they were in this tournament. But you beat Mickey Vago in the final with the Saturdays, and he had everyone else on the planet involved, and became the first and only winner of the 128-man Mega Wrestling Tournament of Doom TM.
I am officially the most popular wrestler in Scotland. We had a vote. It was official. Fact. Well, the Electoral College decided, not the media.
That
joke should be out of date by February, sorry.
Who knows, to be honest? It could be, might not be.
He's still there.
He's still there, sitting in the same chair, just going, nope.
SWN listeners, today is the 29th of November. Trump is still in the White House. Is he still in the White House in February? Has he still not left? Has he chained himself to the fence?
I've seen a gif of a Trump lookalike on a bouncy and a space hopper just refusing to leave. That's it now. So yeah, we're in 2021 and I'm hazarding a guess and saying that Trump is still in the White House somewhere, cryogenically frozen and like like Han Solo in Star Wars, and he's just in a room somewhere, just frozen somewhere forever. He'll never leave. So we spoke about ADM. He sent in a question in our first round of looking for questions, asking who's his favourite opponent and why is it me? Assuming he means him. So why is your favourite opponent ADM?
ADM is one of my favourite opponents because he's somebody that actually listens to what I want to do in a match. Which any wrestling guy listening to that was like, yeah, I'm somebody who is, what do you want to do? And you actually want to do stuff. But generally, we are able to kind of just think in the same wavelength as well, like me, and except we don't get on your level, so we're actually able to just think on what do we actually want to do in the match, what kind of creative stuff do we want to do that people's not seeing, what kind of story do we want to actually tell. Like, I think one of the better ones, we've had a great match in the Source Wrestling School, which kind of fell flat with the crowd, the crowd were just that engrossed and amazed that they didn't make any noise, they were speechless. I had a great one in Linux time, which is all about me trying to climb up to be the next champion, and then we eventually had one where I decided it was the precipice of me going on a heel turn. So it was me deciding to, oh, Dave, finally go and take a chair because he's shown that he's not no stranger to taking the shortcut. And eventually, oh no, I'll be honest, and then get smacked with the chair, and it's just that whole, what the hell am I actually doing? So those kind of matches helped create the story arc from what my character would end up doing for the next year. Deciding to go, okay, he says I don't have that killer touch. I was okay, I'll develop that killer touch, and then it came to head when we had a fatal four-way match in Govan, where I finally just hit an opponent with a low blow while he's tied up in the corner and pinned straight in front of him. Whereas my character a year ago wouldn't have done that. He'd have just gone, no, I need to beat the champion, get yourself loose and let's fight. So we end up, we were able to tell a story. If you look at Source for a full year, we were able to tell a story of me going from I want to be the honest champion to you don't have the killer touch, you'll never be as good as me. It's okay, I'll think like you and I'll act like you and I'll beat you for it. So
that's the kind of long-term storytelling that I absolutely love. So unfortunately, because I'm that far away from the shows, I can't go to them live, but if I was watching them back on, say, a YouTube, if they put up the shows back and I got to see that, that would just have me just, especially that last, you said the last bit with ADM tied up and he watched you take his belt away without actually being able to be involved. That's just amazing. I love that. A kind of start to finish kind of thing. What was it like actually winning the Source Wrestling Championship, going from your replica, your child size replica of the World Heavyweight title to actually being told or being given an actual wrestling belt? What were your feeling, your thoughts going through that?
Well, it was surreal. It was great to finally just actually be like, it was my very first title winning in wrestling. So it was great to just have that kind of moment where like, you hold up as like, I'm a villain, so I don't have the crowd cheering for me. I have the crowd just shining abuse at me, and I just get to be that big, despicable guy showing the belt in their face. They're going, it's like, you don't deserve that. And I'm just like, nah, kid, I do deserve this. You don't know what I've been through, kind of deal. It's just like, it adds up to all the kind of past couple of years, the work I put in, that I debuted just as Source was finally itself becoming a promotion. And was in the first tournament where they decided, oh, we're actually going to get a wrestling belt in. And in that tournament as well, as I forget, we had a match with ADM. So he was one of the people that beat me on his way to being the champion. But then kind of going backstage, just going to be kind of, congratulations off of a few people before I make myself like have to go through the crowds and govern to get back up to the change rooms. But I pass my mum, my dad and my brother. They all came there, they're wearing their t-shirts and they get me vote for me. So it's good to kind of just have that wee moment of people that just always kind of like support me and push me when I said I wanted to try and get into wrestling. So it's like they're seeing a bit of success for myself, and you see that kind of getting proud of me. So I'll eventually go up into there because it's a battle royal main event. So it's just one of those. If you've heard the story of Chris Jericho when he won the Undisputed title, and you think, oh, there must have been a big party for him, there's like, oh, not everybody had left the venue because of the main event. And then he eats cold pizza outside his hotel room because he's locked out. It's just one of those kind of. I eventually go from that big, finally done something I've always wanted, and then have that weekend kind of knocked back down. I was like, okay, nah, here's reality still. So it was one of those good ones that I don't become egomaniacal. But it was good to eventually kind of to have Source kind of go, right, we kind of see something in you to do something with the title and help us kind of move into the next kind of part.
I love that you mentioned that the ADM beat you in the tournament as well. That just adds that extra. It's like an onion. You and ADM are old Shrek. You guys, so many layers.
Kick of layers.
to the story. So you've wrestled a fair bit since then, around about, including a stint under a mask as well, in Power Forward. Yeah. What was it like? I mean, I've spoken to guys like Talon Jr. and I will have spoken to Lucha DS when this comes out, and they've got masks that obviously don't. So you're wearing masks before it was the norm anyway, nowadays. But how is it like wrestling with your mouth covered and restricting your breathing and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, it's one of the things that anti-maskers are kind of half right. Yeah, it's hard to breathe, but only when you're trying to do an actual bloody wrestling match. If you're just going to the shops, it's all right. But it's one of those ones where it's kind of weird just having the mask on you. You're trying to kind of take in a big sharp inhale breath when you've just ran through a quick spot, and it's just one of those ones like, okay, right, just push through it. But we're lucky it was a trio, so most of the time we're not wrestling single matches. But it's a weird experience having to wrestle with a mask on, because like your mask wrestlers will end up telling you you need to be more and more animated with your body as well to convey emotion and story for a match. But it was a good mask as well, because it wasn't just like stuck on me. I had to tape up the back because it was just kind of velcroed over, but it helped. It was okay to kind of stay fixed. Sometimes you'd have that week in a moment where you've just ran for a spot or just had somebody in a head put you in a headlock and you're a bit ski whiff, you're like, that has come your eyes a wee bit, you need to readjust. It was just those wee kind of quick moments of readjust your mask. But it was an experience I think like a lot of wrestlers need to do, just to have like one of those. It's just like losing an arm, because your face is one of those things that you use to tell stories within wrestling, and it allows you to try and express in different ways as well.
And the weird thing as well is you're not supposed to be Grant McIvor in that moment. You're supposed to be one of Power Forward. So you could be animated, but then you've got to be consciously think, well, I can't be as animated as I usually am, because people will go, oh, that's Grant McIvor there.
I can't wrestle like Grant McIvor. I can't try and walk and move like me. I was one of those ones where I was like, I put a kind of cane wig over the mask so I can just hide my blonde hair, because there was people that I weren't kind of going, oh, is it Grant McIvor? And all they were thinking it was Zero for a good while. And I'm just like, is my hairline that bad now? But it was one of those ones that the wrestling fans are kind of going, is it Zero? I think we think it's Zero. Is the hair looks kind of that sense? And then you just have my pal, like, went to Square, go and see me do a run-in. And then he just clicked on my brother who went away for a pint. I was like, you just missed Grant. And I was like, what? Grant's not here. I'm here because I told him to go along with the ads. It's like, I'm not doing this. I'm actually going to be posting pictures backstage at ICW of me and you in the pub. So it throws off people. It was like, well, Grant's just posted that he's somewhere else. So it's definitely no ICW. But my couldn't hoodwink my pals, because they're just like, I know how you walk and move and wrestle. I go to see you all the time.
Okay.
It's just that one person that's screaming is like Miley Stewart as Hannah Montana. How are you guys not seeing this?
I can just imagine you though. I'm just going, oh, Zero as you're going. I think you find us, dot. Just I just imagine she's going, no, it's not, it can't be.
It's just watching ICW on demand, it's like, is that me? I don't remember that.
So under the mask and that, just to kind of not stop speaking about the wrestling, but we can't not speak about your recent appearance as of recording on the WWE Network, which is where you're speaking about your Christian Cage shiny pants and tracksuit combo. I think the WWE Network put down that it was on in June. I don't know if that's accurate to when you actually did
no.
it.
The taping happened on October 3rd, and I remember that because as Mean Girl referenced October 3rd, which I was guessing about. I was like, well, when am I going back to wrestling? It's October 3rd. So it was like, we get the kind of information back that we're looking to run quite very sterilised tapings. Like, essentially, there's a big skeleton crew. Like, you've seen, there's a full episode that's on the WWE Network right now, which is available for $9.99. Get my plug in. The sponsorships here. You can see that I'm part of the Lionheart League, and I'm just part with Stevie James, Stevie Boy, and Liam Thompson, who's just us four in there. So it's like, essentially, we are just in there ourselves for about 3 to 4 hours, and we all wrestle each other once. And it was a very big wake-up call for me to find out that my first wrestling show back, I'm wrestling 3 matches within 4 hours. It was one of those ones, I was like, okay, how long have I got in advance to get back in shape?
So that was your bubble then. So when people are watching it, people will have watched this because I think they'll all be out by the time this comes out. But so yeah, you had your that was your bubble four guys. The only guys you'd be interacting with, of course, other than the referee, he'd be keeping back as much as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. The entire production crew are all to themselves, and you can see them wearing their face masks. We are told to just come in with our face masks as well whenever we're backstage. We're all protected, and the only people we physically interact with are the people we're wrestling with, and we're all checked beforehand as well, which is good.
So did you have to get the actual COVID tests themselves, or was it just temperature checks?
Yeah, I got COVID tested, like, as part of my kind of job as well, so just make sure I'm feeling okay, just make sure I'm getting tested. We're always getting temperature checked as well when we go in. If we get temperature checked and we're above, it's a way home. I've heard a few folk have had to actually do that, which is a shame, but it's very safe tonight, which is I'm quite happy with. And there's a few places in the UK like Red Pro that have started up, and there's places like Ring of Honor that have started their backup, their taping, which is good. So we're getting to a point where if procedures are properly put in place, wrestling can come back on an on-demand service. I just can't wait for the actual crowds to get back in when we can.
Yeah, I'm very glad to hear that, because I think, of course, we're trying to restrict mention of the actual company itself, so we'll just keep saying WWE Network. But I'm glad to hear that that's put in place, because, of course, there's in our company trying to run shows at this time, which doesn't sound like they have any regulations, and more a case of, we're going to put on shows. Come watch. And you're like, what have you done? It's. I'm glad to hear that it's as bubbled as possible, and there is no chance of you're not going to be interacting with anyone outside of that league block. And I haven't actually watched it in full, but I'm assuming that they've got a different referee for the other block as well, so it keeps it as separate as possible. And I'm very glad to hear that, because the last thing I want wrestling back as much as the next person, but I don't want it at the cost of any lives at the same time. Because I think I've said in many other interviews, I'm thinking autumn next year is when we're going to get crowds back. That's probably the first time I'll get to see a show again. But at least this way, like I say, 3-4 hours, you've been tested, and then that's you until whenever the next time may be. So, of course, I don't want any spoilers at this stage because we're recording before the actual show goes out, and this will go on Patreon as well, so people can't actually, people can listen to it tomorrow if they pay me £5, and they'll find out who wins if I ask who wins the tournament. But so I won't ask any more than that. I just I said, glad to know that that company's done all they can to make sure you guys are as safe as possible for that block. What was it like wrestling in front of nobody?
Oh, it was amazing. I don't need worry about crowd reactions. It's like one of those ones, it's like we can go out and just get our feedback. I was like, because it's like I haven't been able to actually physically wrestle with anyone, even when we went back to when the wrestling schools opened up for a period. Essentially, it was just getting back into ring shape. We can't physically interact with anybody. We're still boxed off. Like, I don't, source wrestling itself has a structure where you have to be within a certain area to do your workout, and like literally there's no training for like wrestling holds or taking or doing moves or bumps or whatever. It was all just back to getting back into fitness, which I was glad I had that lever. But it was getting back into wrestling ring, and we warm up, we just do a bit of wrestling, and then we take that first bump back in, take that first move, and you're just like, so it was very good to just finally get back in. But it was one of those ones that you had having to wrestle again. It's like, how do I do this again? How do I move into this? Can I move? How do I put on this? It was just one of those ones that just, okay, everything needs to come back right on. And it was weird because you're having to practice essentially when you're performing.
So because that'll be the first time you've actually got to, as weird as it's going to sound, touch someone for a very long time. It sounds so weird. The other thing is, again, it's not something we're going to labour on because it's not a happy subject, but there was a big regime change in Source as well. So for between lockdown starting and you starting training again, it's all changed. So was that also another bit of intrepidation, is that the word I'm looking for? Going back to training and seeing how the landscape was with a bit more of a new role.
So essentially we kind of had a big meeting because of one, the COVID procedures that were getting put into place. One, we needed to be educated on what was going to go ahead with the school, if we were going to go ahead with coming in during this period. But we're allowed to come in back in the train, but here's what we're going to have to try and do, minimise whatever spread like possibly could be, and just introduce what's happening with the school now. So we now have the man not formerly known as Robbie Solar, Robbie Wishart, is one of the coaches. David Devlin is the head coach now. But basically, he took case here like day to day. Got Glendon Barr, one of our head coaches now, and Flying Ryan Griffin has been brought in as a coach. He works as a personal trainer, so he's bringing more of his fitness experience back in to Source. So now we have four main coaches over at Source.
That's a total change as well. It must be nice. Not the situation that came to it was nice, but it must be nice to see like Glenn Dunbar, your first official opponent, 1-on-1. He's now the guy that's kind of guiding you as well as you continue your training. So it's kind of like a little bit for yourself, a little bit full circle. This is the guy that tried to help me first, and now he's continuing this kind of legacy kind of thing as well. But no, it's a very odd situation. I don't think anyone's still properly wrapped their head. I mean, this is just from a fan's perspective. Nobody's kind of wrapped their heads around it. I can only imagine, especially it's your home promotion, your home school, how awkward and how much of a change it was, doing all that kind of, not being part of it, but obviously you're their champion for that promotion, and you're kind of, lack of a better term, the face of it, and then having to go, how navigate it. Yeah. For someone who's very active in social media, did you find that quite difficult to kind of try not to address, but at the same time not address it? it seemed.
It was just one of those ones that I don't want to get into any kind of discussions or conversations about it. I just stand here and say support for anyone who was speaking out at the time. You had kind of people that, for lack of a better term, some people were kind of putting their food in their mouths, just getting in arguments. It's one of those ones where you're not doing like the person any favours. Also, almost a kind of point scoring to an extent, but it's just one of those ones where I just wanted to kind of sit and just, if I had to look at from my Twitter and see a lot of kind of statements coming out, it was just listen and like take everything in.
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, that's what we had to do. That's what I had to do as well. I was pretty much spending every day when it was coming out, daily deleting things, and then once I'd finished deleting it, I'd go, right, it's fine. 600 things gone. Go to Twitter. Back to the website. Let's get more stuff. But it's just like I say, we're not going to labour on it because I don't know the full details. You can only talk about what you know as well. We don't know all the details. We'll move on. Let's speak about happy stuff. So if anyone's got their bingo card out, we're going to probably tick one off here with Ian Skinner. He has asked, what's your favourite Simpsons reference?
Who the hell is Ian Skinner? Simpsons reference. I don't really watch The Simpsons.
Nah. I've heard it's alright.
I'm trying to think. We'll look up the last Simpsons meme that I saved on my phone. Well, we have King Homer sitting there. Well, your Patreon viewers will get to see King Homer. But let's see. Last Simpsons meme. Well, last Simpsons meme is just MacGyver over and over again, because if you watch the newest episode that's on the WWE Network, sometimes when Billy Kirkwood gets excited, he says MacGyver instead of MacIvor.
I'm going to put that on there at your wrestling spotlight, also known as
MacGyver. So MacGyver's the newest one, and if it's not MacGyver, it is... I say, you can never go wrong with steamed hams. Steamed hams is a lot.
I see steamed hams quite a lot. Yeah. Not saying that you've overplayed steamed hams, but I know that's a good... That and poochie, I think, are two kind of good, strong go-tos for the Simpsons memes. I tried it during one of the NXT takeovers. I got nothing. I had the Johnny Gargano one. Yeah. When Johnny Gargano's not on the screen, people must be asking, Where's Johnny Gargano? And I was laughing to myself, and I got no likes, and I was like, that is comedy gold. That's comedy gold. And
I'm a bit desensitized to it now, but there was a point where I kind of feel weird. Just my entire Facebook was just me, or just Simpsons memes, because I was part of so many Simpsons groups. But it was just like, I've made my bed. I've accepted it. This is my life. I just skipped past them. It was like, why lose one? But when I first saw it, I was like, oh no, I need to read every Simpsons meme that comes on here. Now I can just go, that's a Harrison. And a Harrison has been done. I don't know if you remember that episode with the B-Sharps. George Harrison comes by to see the Simpsons on the B-Sharps on the rooftop and just goes, it's been done. It's a reference to the
Beatles. Fun fact, the Beatles played in Elgin one time. At the Two Red Shoe Theatre, so there's a wee fun fact for people that are listening. The Beatles played in Elgin. I don't know if it was on top of the rooftop, but definitely was here. Apparently, I don't know. Could be a lie. We're Bonnie Prince Charlie here. No, there's no witnesses. They just said. Dalen Hendry. I'm not sure if I'm saying that name right, and I'm possibly got him in season two.
You got it. It's okay.
Oh, right. That's good. I'm going to get it wrong when I speak to him. I know it. He's put best wonder kid he has found on Football Manager. So who's your best wonder kid?
Okay, right. This depends on what position, because we need to kind of go through a few things here. So in right back, we had Alan McAllister. I may need to look this up as well, but Alan McAllister, I think I signed for $1.8 million. Team I was playing is Celtic. 1.8 million, sold him to Liverpool for about 10 million. Good profit, 9 million. Who else? Fernando Garcia, the man so nice, named him twice. I think I got him for 2.3 and I sold him to Chelsea for 20 million. So say he's my best one. My worst one was Chris Jordan, a boy I signed from Hull, I think a 20-year-old I signed from Hull for about 19 million. I got him on a 3-year contract, and after repeatedly just try to say, and it was last year, just sign a contract, sign a new contract so I can sell you. Is that I want to leave the club. Is that if you sign a new contract, I will sell you. But nah, he let his contract run out and signed with Chelsea on a free. So 19 million down the drain. And he was mediocre. He was absolutely mediocre. Like, not even worth mentioning. I just lost Alexis Sanchez on a free to Arsenal, but he was 31 and he'd played with me 11 seasons and won me 2 Golden Boots, a Champions League, and 11 league titles in a row. So he can go. He can go. You've done F old Chris Jordan. Oh, thank you, Dale. You just brought up some annoying memories.
I don't know how Football Manager works, whether there is a Chris Jordan out there, but I'm assuming if you ever see Chris Jordan footballer, you'll be like, I hate you.
He's a regen. He's lucky. The game made him after I went too far in.
Football Manager, I've only ever played it on the Game Boy. That was as close as that's. Well, wasn't even that. Was on an emulator. I played it. So it was the 1999 onwards season. So I was like, yeah, Man United, I'm going to buy Nicholas Anelka. That's a good investment. That. So yeah, that's about as I stopped watching football around about probably about then as well. So it was a case of I was kind of the same as yourself. You're like you're more interested in football than you were wrestling. I became more interested in wrestling, and football just disappeared from my life forever. When I stopped being able to play, when everyone else is better than me, I was like, I'm not playing anymore. I'm going to watch the people pretend to fight instead. That's way more fun. So we had an interaction about the tournament, 128 wrestler tournament of doom. We also had a very brief but very interesting chat about boy band members. I think this was the questions for possibly Stone Malone, I think it was. Were you always into the cheesy boy band stuff when you're younger and you have to hide it? Or was it just this more recent thing? How did you get there?
I think it is a good bit of 90s nostalgia. I'm trying to look at the thing here and I can't really see them. I think they're actually cut away from my... No, there's a good few here. So for your lucky Patreon viewers will be able to see some of my S Club 7 collection.
Oh, nice.
Cheesy pop when I was a kid, that was mainly into. It was mainly Steps and S Club 7. But they're good. Well, there's some girl members and some boy members. It's a mix. I like to kind of watch if it was just kind of general, just completely girls, Spice Girls, or even boys in sync. I like Steps. Steps are really kid-friendly and cheesy. And so S Club, they've got a TV show on CBBC. Did Backstreet Boys have a TV show on CBBC? No. So S Club is better. But it's a big 90s nostalgia. So I end up kind of just loving just to listen back to... Everyone listening here that loves wrestling is a big Wayne inside. They love wrestling because that's what they watch when they're a kid. They've got tons of geeky stuff. Most of us still play video games. Most of us still watch up TV shows that we watched as a kid. It's the whole reason I got back into wrestling, because The Rock came back and I was turning 18 and I was like, I'm grown up. This is scary. Let's go back to watching Power Rangers and wrestling and Boy Meets World.
Yep. That's my wheelhouse now. I can listen to I listen to Radio 2 now. I'm at the age where Radio 2 is the one to go for, because Radio 1's scary. And there's too many noises, and I'm just like, no, play Steps. I would like to listen to Steps, please. I think it was one of those. I've top 40 when I was younger. Yeah. It's a nostalgia thing. You had your Steps, and you always had your favourite. For Steps, for some reason it was Lisa, because she was the prettiest, but unfortunately she could not sing. She was just there for dancing, I suppose. So you always had your favourite in the band for either looks or for actual ability. It's just nice and exactly that nostalgia thing. But no, Steps are still throwing out the bangers. Their newer ones are just still, they're Waterman classics. They're just ace. My wife is humongous into that, the Waterman era and all that kind of stuff. So I'm allowed to be that kind of nerd. I don't have to go, no, I like cool bands. Like, God, I can't even think of a cool band. That's how.
It's not even bands anymore. It's DJs and rappers. That's what it is. DJs and rappers that don't actually rap. They just kind of mumble.
I know, but back in our day, we had Blue. We had Simon Webb who did the rapping. Because for whatever reason, he did the rapping bits in Blue for no reason whatsoever. And they had your 911s. I was due to go to Westlife this, 2020 when this goes out. So when we record it. So I was due to go to Westlife this year. I was so excited because they were coming to Inverness. And I was like, yes, I'm going to go see Westlife. I didn't tell anyone because I didn't want people to know I was going to go see Westlife. But and then it got cancelled, and I was sadder than I thought I'd be sadder about it. I was like, oh, now my wings have been clipped. I won't be able to fly. That pretty much it's a nostalgic thing, right? So, what would be your favourite Steps song? I could probably go through a list of cheesy bands here, and we'll just go through favourites.
Favourite Steps song would be Tragedy. It was about the one I knew as a kid, knew the dance moves to it. Dance moves came on the back of the CD.
Always.
Had that hand pat down. It was a wee quick trivia fact, because I don't know when you might get him on the show. Luke Matthews, I remember hearing this, listening to the story. So Luke Matthews' girlfriend was telling the story of how she went on a first date with him. And she was saying, he asked me out to a Steps and Venga Boys concert. And the last she's telling this story too, is just going, him. The guy with the bald head, big beard, and machine head tattoo that spread across his chest. Actually, you go to Steps and Megan Boys, like, no chance. But it was Sammy Joe and Matt Daly's engagement party we were at. And Sammy Joe herself loves her cheesy 90s. So 5, 6, 7, 8 comes on, and Luke Matthews does the dance bit for bit, beat by beat. And the lass is just staring, looking at it like, how? How's this bank off knowing exactly every dance 2, 5, 6, 7, 8? I can't even remember 5, 6, 7, 8.
That's the one I know, because I did it at my mate's wedding. My wife got up and girlfriend at the time, she started doing it, and I was like, I remember this. And then by the end of it, we had a wee corner where we were both side by side doing 5, 6, 7, 8. I would love to go to a Steps. That sounds amazing, Steps and Venga Boys.
Steps was my very first concert as well, 1998.
Oh, man.
SECC.
Mine was way... Mine was Pink, 2006. And
I've never seen Pink. Pink always kind of just went kind of by me. But she was the mainstream acceptable punk artist.
But no, it was weird. Pink was the first gig, and then 2 weeks later, I was back at the AACC to see my first WWE event as well. It was Rated RKO versus DX in the main event, so it was a little bit of difference, but still just about the same amount of performance as well.
I have been to a gig in the AACC, right enough. It was to see Blink-182 because the Glasgow ticket sold out. So it was just one of those ones, like, I've not seen them in years. Me and my brother just went and got a bus up to Aberdeen, stayed overnight in a hotel and seen them, and then went home.
That'd be a band I'd want to see when it's the original lineup. Yeah. I don't know if I'd want to see them.
There was a Skiba lineup that we went and seen, but it was still good. So it's still, like, Matt Skiba is really good in Alkaline Trio. And the last Blink-182 album was really good. 9 was really good. If you just give it a listen, Dark Side is a really good track off of it. And the song Quarantine was actually quite good, which they recorded during quarantine.
I'll definitely give it a chance.
And also Travis Barker produced the new Machine Gun Kelly, which is amazing. I can't believe I'm actually unironically loving a Machine Gun Kelly album after Invincible from WrestleMania 28.
If anyone was watching the video, I may have just went a little bit blank because I was trying to remember who Machine Gun Kelly was. And all I remember, did you see the guy Kevin Owens? Silly. Did Kevin Owens throw him off a powerbomb off the stage? Ah, okay. Yeah. Speaking wrestling to men, I'll understand it. But yeah, okay. I know who that man is. It's the same with K-Fed. I had no idea who he was. Yeah. If anyone says, K-Fed, like, oh, yeah. John Cena beat him up. I remember him. what about Westlife then? Best Westlife songs? I have our list. I don't have a top 10, but I do have ones that are like top tier.
Best Westlife song, basically, first off, straight away, is Fly My Fight Wings. Best original one, I'd say. Best cover? I'm going to think, what's the best cover? Best cover might be Uptown Girl. I don't know if Uptown Girl may have actually started the whole, like, that same just doing covers. Just give my head, Bop Baby. That's such an...
Oh, yes! Bop Baby is... I think it annoys my wife so much because it's one of my absolute favourites and she hates it. It's one of her least favourite Westlife songs. And I'm like, yes, Bop Baby, that's the one. It's the one that stopped their number one run because it went to number three. Yeah. But I don't care. It's a bloody good song. I like some good ones off their first couple albums, like their hidden tracks. Like Imaginary People is a good one. There's a load of good one on their concerts. Back Again is a good one as well. I don't know how I've ran myself down this rabbit hole and I'm not getting out of it. But yeah, Westlife songs, they did not get the respect. They're like the Eddie Guerrero to me. Did not get the respect at the time, in my opinion. And then now they went away. They're finally getting it. But cover for me, I go Daughtry's What About Now.
Oh, that's good.
That's a good one.
I remember when that came out, and that ended up sending me down a Daughtry rabbit hole, which is weird because it's... He seems like a nice guy, but Daughtry's a very mediocre Midwest rock band. For some reason, I binged the first two albums when I was 18 or something. I don't know why.
But no, but every time I listen to them, there's their last song before they went on their big break was Lighthouse, and the only reason it went out is because Gary Barlow wrote it. But there's a song on that album that's... I can't remember what it's called. I know it. I'm not going to sing it for everyone's ears. But it's. But you listen to it on the album, you know that's their last song. Wonderful World. Wonderful World is called. That's their last song. But it never went out because they wanted to put out the Gary Barlow one instead, which was just
it's gonna sell.
What do you think of their new album, Spectrum?
I've only heard a few songs off of it. I'm sure I think what is it? It was the first one that kind of came out for it.
Something about love, was it? Love. Oh, I can't remember. I should know this.
Hello, my love. Hello, my love. It's like if you're going to come back after being away for a while, that's a song to come back with.
Absolutely.
But it's I don't think it's going to be the same kind of like musical landscape for them to like proper stand out. It's weird. It's weird, like McFly is coming back as well, but I don't think, like, just say, like, doing Take That came back, Take That, for some reason, just had that complete nostalgia trip for so many people. And I'm not sure if kind of Westlife's going to be that exact same, because how different music is now with streaming services, which is a wee bit weird.
And yeah, I mean,
while we're on the subject about can I take that, can I come back, can I just say, NSYNC. Take That came back without Robbie because Robbie was up his own and was like, nah, I don't want to come back to Take That. I'm making millions on my EMI records. Listen to my rap album, guys.
Loved it. Rude Box.
And of course, Justin Timberlake just doing extremely well as a Hollywood actor, that even when he did an MTV performance of his last album, which was 7 years ago, it's been 7 years since a Justin Timberlake album, by the way, which is good. He was like, we'll bring back NSYNC, but it's literally for a minute during my 30-minute performance. We're going to sing a snippet of three songs and then I'm going to go back down in the wee elevators out of the stage. And I'm just like, guys, get back together, get a Las Vegas wedding, Susie, put music out, you can actually come back, you don't need Justin. Joey Fatone is a better singer anyway.
Even if you had to go through being called Joey Fat One for years, so you would still, yes, still belt out a tune. And they've got an actual astronaut. They've got a bastronaut.
Lance Bass, JC, Fatone, I forget the other one.
Chris. It's Chris.
Kirkpatrick. Chris Kirkpatrick, yes. I only remember him because of an Eminem lyric where he slides him off for
some reason. It's Chris Kirkpatrick. It's in the Good Charlotte video for Lifestyles is Rich and Famous, yes, as well, isn't it? Yeah.
Yes, but he's wearing the weird, he has the horrible fashion sense.
The cream blazer, and yes, he's got the really long name, the third, at the end as well. I loved Good Charlotte. They're still coming, my angry music. If I'm having a bit of a rubbish day, I'm like, I need to, I don't want to vent out loud, but I need to like vent, and Good Charlotte does it for me.
I always find Good Charlotte weird, because like, how can you guys be punk and still date Paris Hilton? That doesn't make any sense. So it's like, neither of them. Punk because of Paris Hilton.
I know, but Mum, I never let me get. I like Good Charlotte, and it's because it's like, so, oh, it's punky music.
Yeah.
Mum would always turn around and go, middle class boys play music in their garages. That's what they're doing. <It's> like, stop it, you're ruining it for me. But McFly was in our band I was supposed to see this year. So
yeah,
screw you, COVID, because I was supposed to see McFly also, and that hasn't happened. Yeah. I mean, it's them or Busted. Yeah. I would have wanted to see, but I'm not sure about seeing Busted now. Their newer stuff is a bit too.
Really like it. Like, no, there was an album called Night Driver they kind of brought out, which they tried to change the sound a bit modern-y, which is weird. But then they kind of brought out the last album. The last album, for some reason, they end up having a YouTube drummer on it who I absolutely loved. I end up watching like a ton of his cover videos, and I end up finding that I'm touring with Busted, and I'm the studio drummer on their new album. I'm just like, how this is completely bizarre of these two worlds connecting, and I never imagined that happened. But the last album was really good. The song's called 90s in Reunion. Still kind of retain a weird kind of pop punk essence to them. But Busted always one I've related as well. We had the first two Busted albums. When Charlie went on to Fightstar, it kind of connected with me getting into metal as well, which was good. I was a bit more into metal when Charlie left to do it than Paul from S Club when he went on to do a metal band, which was it's one of those when you find that you're doing that kind of creative thing and you're kind of frustrated. It's like you're making money in a child act, but you're like, I want to do something else. I don't want to. I would like grown-ups to come to my show, not just screaming Wayne's.
And then, and on the flip side, we've got Brian McFadden, who left because he wanted to be a bit more grown up. How's he making his money now? How's he making it?
Is
Boys
Life. Spying conspiracy theories on Twitter. Like, the Irish people hate him. The only time I ever see him come up on Twitter is when folk are calling him an idiot for being a COVID, a hoax, anti-masker kind of.
Oh, God. I mean, I'll be fair to him, Brian McFadden. His first album, his solo album, Irish Sun,
it's
a pretty good album. I'll give him that. And then, he's now making his money out of the band he pretty much didn't want to be in. And now he's with Keith Duffy. Of all of them from Boyzone, Keith Duffy.
Keith Duffy's the kind of bland one, the one that looks like he could actually just be a dad. Every one of them is absolutely handsome, and then he's a five.
Although I'm going to say Mikey Graham is probably hanging around about that low hanging fruit of numbers. He's a good singer. He was the replacement for Ronan when Ronan was sick, but still, he's not the prettiest lad in the world. Have you seen his Irish kung fu film?
I have not.
I don't know if you're an OSW review fan, but it's a Fatal Deviation. It's an Irish kung fu film, and Jimmy Bennett, or as he called himself, Jimmy Binney, was an Irish kung fu-er, and he made his own film, and the baddie was Mikey Graham from Boyzone. And I've never actually, it's like The Room. I've never seen The Room, but I've watched OSW review.
Never seen The Room?
Never seen The Room. Every bit I see of it, I go, I'm just going to cringe for so long watching this.
The last time I watched it all the way through, I still drank, so I was drunk watching it, which was okay. But it's one of those ones, but if you just even just watch a review of it online, just like them, I just watch all the good bits. No, I tell a lie, I went to the GFT to see it. But it was one of those ones where we've got this wee game where we just like, oh, you've got a sheet you're kind of instructed to do. We were given spins, tons of plastic spins, which part of me was kind of like, why were we given spins? And it's something I realised before, every picture frame in the room is literally just like somebody bought it out of it, Home Bargains, and it still has the stock picture in it, of which is just spins. They didn't have the money or the time to just, all right, we'll take pictures of each other and put them in the frames. It's just, nah, it's just spins. Just put picture frames all around the room.
Last film I remember watching when I was drunk was Frozen, the first Frozen. Yeah. Never seen it before. I was just absolutely just so drunk. I had a kebab. I thought, I downloaded it, obviously legally for anyone watching. And I was watching it, and when the twist happened, I was just like, oh, no way! I was 20 when this happened. I was just eating my kebab, just going, oh, this is amazing! Right.
I like Frozen, but I feel that Disney are doing the twist endings a bit too much. Like, it's one of those ones where you're like, oh, everyone, you don't get a memorable villain because they decide to be a villain in the last 20 minutes. You want a villain that's chewing up the scenery for the entire hour and a half, which is brilliant. But okay, yeah. Some of them are quite good.
But no, yeah, Frozen. I love Frozen 2 as well. No, I'm not afraid.
I'm still seeing that right now.
So I think we're almost like starting to creep towards 2 hours, maybe. So I think we're going to have to start speak about wrestling or just go down another rabbit hole, because I see the Harry Potter books behind you, and that's a whole other world of stuff to speak about. What would be your, I hate to use the word because I'm 30 years old, what is your fandoms? What's your current fandoms?
Okay, so our fandoms include The Simpsons. But we'll just go through all the meme posting sites. I'm on Facebook. So it's Grubs, IT Crowd, Simpsons, Harry Potter. What did we have? Maybe about Hamilton recently during lockdown. I got binging.
Can we be best
Hamilton.
Friends? I'm taking all of these. Yes, yes.
I'm trying to get myself back more into Pokemon. I never really got past Gen 2 with Pokemon.
Gen 3 for me, that was my stopping point.
I'm going to go through there. Buffy is one of my big ones. We've got a few Power Ranger pop vinyls lying about here. And Scott Pilgrim, big Scott Pilgrim mark.
When did Kevin you stop Smith, with Power Rangers?
When I stopped, I think Ninja Storm was the actual one I stopped kind of watching properly. Well, I've had the point, I think, where I got to maybe like 7 or 8 where I stopped watching Power Rangers properly. I was a Mighty Morphin kid from the start, I think. Mighty Morphin, Zeo in space, and then I just fell away from it, just watched something else. And then eventually I was kind of hanging around with people, and Time Force was on, and they were on to Time Force. But it was like, when I was like, I'm not too much into it, even though Time Force, the villain in Time Force is Bennett from Commando, which is weird. The big villain in Commando is the villain in Time Force, which is a bizarre fact. But then Wild Force came on Jetix, so I ended up just watching Wild Force and then Ninja Storm when I was just about finishing primary school.
Zeo, I watched a little bit of In Space, and then I fell away from it. And I came back a little bit for Dino Thunder because I had Tommy. So I was definitely going to watch it for a bit.
Anything with Tommy.
Yeah, absolutely. But it wasn't my favourite, but he's definitely the best Power Ranger. There's a difference between favourite and best, but definitely the best one.
Pop for you, my favourite Power Ranger was Billy growing up.
I liked Billy because he was called Billy.
Yeah.
But my favourite was Jason. I was just like, who's your favourite Power Ranger? Jason. Not Billy. No. Jason. I love Jason. That's it. Scrubs, love it. I've very much, there's not a day goes by where I'm not annoying my wife about Scrubs. Thankfully, it took me a long time to get her to watch it, because the only time she ever watched was like bits and pieces out of sync. And when I finally got her to watch it, start to finish, she finally appreciated it. And we can replay all the favourite jokes that we can. Every Monday is Bongo Day. So that's it now. And we always, the bidet joke is my absolute favourite, which we always try to catch each other out with. So use the thing that shoots water up your butt. Scrubs. I could probably do a whole thing. Are you listening to Fake Doctors, Real Friends?
Yeah, I've listened to a good few episodes right now. I can't go off and on, because me and Ryan Griffin always have that kind of argument, who's the bigger fan of Scrubs. He listens to the podcast quite regularly. I'm in and out. Just he kind of end up laughing, because I've been into looking up character actors recently, which is weird. But I was end up listening to them kind of talk about how a lot of them were just working as character actors in Hollywood. And TV shows and all the stuff that people have had on, and how when they were writing for Dr. Cox, Melon said, the casting instructions that were looking for a John C. McGinley type. Not John C. McGinley, just somebody that's like, oh, John C. McGinley, you know who I'm talking about. And eventually I just went, do I see John C. McGinley? I think he's available. I mean, we kind of want someone like him, but just not just him. And then just went, oh no, John C. McGinley's Dr. Cox. That's it. So I can't imagine anybody else.
Oh yeah, it's just one of those shows that, I mean, everyone says there's only 8 seasons. I liked season 9 for what it was. But I always have to say that afterwards. I like it for what it was.
I've still to properly finish it. I end up trying to watch it again during lockdown. But it wasn't the quality I could just proper binge it. But I know it was meant to just be a spin-off, but I know for a fact that Bill Lawrence was just kind of like, he was wanting to try and wrap up Scrubs. CBS didn't renew the contract. ABC were going, Scrubs are a good commodity, let's pick up. And he just went, okay, I can finally write season 8 because it shows kind of loses steam, and I can wrap up and give JD his walk-off ending. And then ABC just kind of going, no, you signed the contract. We want more from you. We want more money from Scrubs. And he just went, can I write a spin-off show? It's like, you can write a spin-off show, but we're still calling it Scrubs Season 9 because it's the name Scrubs we want. No, but it's going to be called Med School. We're still going to have characters from Scrubs. Just, it won't be Scrubs. No, it's Scrubs. Like, fine. Scrubs is cancelled. See? Told you.
Yeah, that's always the case. It's like, I always have to say for what it was, because as soon as I go, I liked it, it's always the case of, but it was awful.
Yeah.
No. As a spin-off, it's great.
Wasn't Scrubs. That had the fuel.
So I think my very small notes here. One of the questions is still doing the beard by Colton Davis, but I think everyone watching the video feed knows the answer to that already.
Unfortunately, I'm having to trim it now again myself, because Bad Guy Brand's still not allowed to touch beards, just hair, which is. As soon as he can get his hands on it, so it will get in a good shape. I've just got split ends everywhere, which is annoying. But
I need
to learn beard maintenance. I'm still just getting food in my mustache, and I'm just like, this is annoying.
If bad guy are watching yourself struggle with split ends, I have never maintained this in my life. So I just trim it every so often. Around about the start of lockdown, I had amazing. It was bushy. It was fantastic. And then, I just got turned to one day and just went, that's coming off. And I was like, no. But it got trimmed back, and it's never grown back the same. It's now just like, it just makes my head look rounder somehow. It just grows round. Even if I shave off this and try and grow this bit, it just still goes round. I mean, it's better than having it off. If it gets taken off, I look like a thumb. Yeah. So I've got to kind of weigh up the options here. The other question, I think we'll leave it right to the end, because it feels like a right good wrap-up question. I've got one here. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Velociraptor.
Velociraptor. That seems to be a popular choice. A lot of people are
It's the small worker that goes around.
Are you a fan?
He's smart. Like, Tyrannosaurus Rex looks cool and his badass as hell, but at the same time, he just goes and just demolishes stuff. Like, if you see Velociraptor, you know, it's... You're done.
Like, every time someone says...
It can open doors. Can a Tyrannosaurus Rex open doors? No, he just like that. I mean, you can rip off the roof of a toilet and eat a lawyer right off a toilet, but...
I just can't hear Velociraptor without thinking of Friends when someone asks Ross what he thinks. Yeah, that's it. The sound of a Velociraptor. I'm so glad you got that. I do look like a total idiot when I said it. So what's the... I mean, you're back. You're one of the few at the moment back doing the wrestling at time of recording, which is why I'm taking... You're my last interview until next year, because it's getting really confusing now when I'm two months ahead and I'm just like going, what are you doing this year? And it's 2020, but got to speak about 2021. Now got to, it's just, yeah, that's why you're my last one for now. But for people that are listening to this in the timeline, it'll sound all cool, because next week I'll have a guest and you'll never know the difference. But so any dream opponents, dream matches that you want to do, or you just want to get back to the wrestling?
I do just want to get back into it. Like, this year I was kind of told in advance, like, some people that I'd be going up against, which was looking very lucrative. And then obviously COVID happened, and unfortunately a lot of that stuff didn't come to place. But essentially I'm just looking back to getting my feet back under me in wrestling. I'd like to wrestle some of the mainstay names in Scotland, but in a sense that it kind of helped me get back. Like, when the match that's on right now with Stevie Boy on WWE Network, it was so much better to wrestle someone like him, because he is so good that I can actually lean on him in order to try and get back in, as opposed to if I was just in with someone the same level as me. But I do want to wrestle anybody and anytime again. It's just one of those ones. I want to wrestle somebody that is a lot more experienced than me, that I can get the rub off of, but also want to wrestle with younger guys so I can learn how to be the main guy inside the ring as well, and help just bring up people, because we're going to have to do a lot of rebuilding once we get the crowds in, bring back Scottish wrestling up.
Definitely. I think wrestling's in for I think I did an interview with Scottish Wrestling Discussion, and give them a little plug, even though it's going to be 2 months in the future, saying that wrestling, I think Scottish wrestling's in for another boom period once the crowds come back, because not only is there's less companies, there will be less companies, whether the ones that have already closed before we've discussed or that, there will be less companies, less spots to have when the shows reopen. So it's just going to be good shows. And plus, a lot of places, again, we said earlier, everyone will have their core roster, at least for the first little bit. So it gives a chance to build an audience again. It's going to be, very exciting, weird, scary, but exciting at the same time, I think. The last question I've actually already asked you, which is is a favourite that came through by quite a few folk, including John Young from Fair State Wrestling, which is, are you still doing the wrestling? But I think we know the answer.
Still doing the wrestling.
Still doing the wrestling. Before we hopefully don't spin off too much, why is that a thing? It's just still doing the wrestling.
That's generally, when I started doing it, every kind of wrestler started to kind of chuckle, because why are you saying still doing wrestling? It's like, you know, get folk just going to you, like, you haven't seen them in years, or a few months, it's like, you're still doing wrestling? It's almost, when you get that one, it's almost kind of condescending. Oh, you're still doing the wrestling, pal? And you're just like, I'm still doing the wrestling, I've just been on the WWE Network. And you're like, all right, so you're actually doing well. But it's just one of those, like, family functions. You just be like, how you doing, son? You're still doing wrestling? You're still, no seeing somebody in a while. You're still doing the wrestling? It's got to the point now where someone comes up to me and says, I've not seen a while. You're going, you're still doing the wrestling? It's like, I don't know if they've seen what I've been doing on social media. And they're either going along with a joke or they're genuinely asking, and I'm just kind of laughing. It's one of those ones as well with, like, my brother was working and somebody came in at his work. Just had a wee chat with him, and I was like, oh, how's your brother doing? Is he still doing wrestling? And my brother just started to laugh for a bit, and I saw the guys looking on weird. And he just like, I need to tell you something, he can't explain the reason why I do it. But why I'm saying you still do wrestling? It's like, everybody just keeps going, oh, you still doing wrestling? So he started using that as a gimmick, and he just went, that's absolutely hilarious. That's absolutely brilliant. But the memes you've been seeing on like Instagram or Twitter, it's just like, it's all been like TV related. So the end game is just like, oh, Grant, you're still doing the wrestling? I was like, aye, but it's, everything's TV related, and it's just me lying on the couch watching TV. I was like, nah, I'm still doing the wrestling. I've convinced myself I'm still doing the wrestling. But all the TV shows I've been watching has just been bleeding into my head. Nah, I'm still doing the wrestling. Like, I'm just comatose. I'm just like Jack Nicholson lying in one floor of the cuckoo's nest. Like, I'm still doing the wrestling, son. Me and I care home when I'm 70. Like, I'm still doing the wrestling.
What's weird is, I mean, it absolutely works and it's hilarious, yeah, and everything, but I get that as well. And I think it's just because, yeah, I was that kid. It's always a wrestling kid.
Is that, yeah, you're still into wrestling?
Still into the wrestling. Oh, I've seen the WWF. Not John Cena. And I'm just sitting there thinking, you're trying, but I need to, yeah, correct you. I'm not going to correct you, because if I start, I'm going to keep speaking. Yeah. I don't want to speak to you anymore.
Oh, you're watching that WWF, son, aye?
Oh, yeah.
Is it The Undertaker still wrestling?
Yes, that's it. It's always that one. Mind The Undertaker. Is he still going? I must be getting all new.
Yeah, you do wrestling, son. Do you know Grado?
Yep, that's odd. Do you King Grado?
You getting Grado? Oh, he's funny, ain't he?
Oh, so I saw him on the Scott Squad. I saw him in the River City.
My friend Kyle, his gran worked as an extra, was doing extra work on River City, I think, and he was just like, oh, so I was talking with Grado, and I was like, oh, I seen him when I was on River City. Last time I was just like, almost every time I see him, I'm just like, oh.
Yeah, it's busting seats. I do enjoy it. It works. I agree. Any thoughts? I mean, if anyone wants to tap you for River City, are you game for it, or are you just quite happy just to do the wrestling?
No, it's been a while since I've done extra work. I used to do extra work when I was in high school. I wanted to try and become an actor, but that fell by the wayside quite quickly.
Feels
as
like
that's
another story, but we have hit 2 hours.
We will talk about my 5 second appearance in our episode of Taggart called Local Hero, which is...
Oh, there you go. Write that down. Taggart. Local Hero.
Hopefully this podcast episode doesn't air a longer period after I did that episode. I think I did that. I filmed that episode in 2008. And then eventually got to air in 2010, which was for some reason Taggart was reaching the point where it's like, oh no, we're not doing episode by episode weekly. It's nah, we'll release an episode and then like, we'll let you know in a few months if I put the L on it.
I'll go check the IMDb now.
Yeah.
Taggart, local hero, source wrestling champion, Grant McIvor. Anyway, right, where can people find you on social media?
I think I've cleaned it up easily now, but you can find me on @TheOneGrantMcIvor on Instagram, Twitter. I've got a Reddit now, but I still need to try and get Reddit content on. TikTok as well, but I haven't been on TikTok since middle of quarantine. But @TheOneGrantMcIvor on Twitter and Instagram is where I'm most active, and hopefully I can get some TikTok footage back on once the wrestling's proper back.
Awesome. So for those that are listening on the Patreon, watching the Patreon, you can see Grant McIvor on WWE Network. You might still be able to see him when this comes out live, but thank you for joining me. And I'm sure we'll get a part 2 once we actually do have the wrestling back.
All right, man. Thank you very much for having us. Enjoy meeting you.